Good morning to everyone. On behalf of the management and the faculty members of Dr. M.G.R. Janaki College for Women, I welcome you all for this 4 days national webinar on impact and applications of Industry 4.0 after lockdown, organized by the departments of Computer Science, Computer Applications, and the PG Department of Information Technology. Today is the fourth day of the webinar session titled Internet of Things. We have Professor Amit K. Nerurkar as a resource person from Vidyalankar Institute of Technology, Mumbai, to deliver a talk on Internet of Things. Professor Amit has 11 years of teaching experience and presented many research papers in the reputed journals. His area of interest includes computer networking, network security, distributed systems, and IoT. He has been invited as an expert speaker in the field of networking at various institutions in Mumbai. He was a convener for CSA VIT chapter, and he also obtained global certification of STAR for C programming too. Professor Amit, we're extremely happy to have you as the resource person for this session. I wish all the participants are benefited through this session. General reminder to all the participants, attendance link will be posted in the chat box after the half an hour of this session begins, and feedback form will be posted in the chat box before the end of the session. I request all the participants to fill up the feedback form to generate their e-certificate automatically to their registered email. Queries raised by the participants in the chat box will be answered at the end of the session. Over to Professor Amit.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Uma Madam, for such a warm welcome.
Thank you, sir.
I'll just share my screen, and then, well and good, we would start with the introduction part of what exactly is IoT. I believe my screen is visible. So let's proceed with
visible, sir. Visible.
Yeah, thank you so much. So let's proceed with what exactly is IoT. So IoT, which stands for Internet of Things. So to first start with what exactly is IoT, I would introduce myself that I am working as an assistant professor in Vidyalankar Institute of Technology. And being a reputed institute set up in Mumbai, this is a small details about my institute, my college, set up in Mumbai, Wadala. We are having engineering, we are having MBA, we are having BSc courses, diploma courses. So well and good, let's start with what actually is IoT. So friends, you know IoT stands for Internet of Things. So when I say Internet of Things, let us first understand who is the inventor of IoT. So the person named Kevin Aston, this person has coined this term known as Internet of Things. Now, what exactly is Internet of Things? Let's divide it as Internet of and things. When I say internet, immediately what comes to your mind is nothing but computer network. But when I'm talking about things, it is any damn object. It can be living, it can be non-living, which has a capability of communicating some information, transferring some useful data. So when I'm talking about IoT, we never ever imagined a refrigerator reminding us to get a milk. Possibly there is no milk today. So what you can see in this image, a refrigerator is reminding the user to get the milk. So IoT is nothing but it is a communication between different objects that would give some meaningful information. So what exactly is IoT? Okay, we came to know by the definition of the interconnected objects, interconnected devices. But then we first really understand how this term IoT was brought into this world. So it started with something known as people to things. So when you check this, people to things, initially it was the mobile phones. Then possibly the mobile phones started becoming more and more smarter. To make it smarter, other than processing, what was involved to make it more smarter was internet. So a person wearing a smart band or a smart watch and giving a real-time information like what is the ECG value, what is the heart rate value, what is the how much amount of steps he has walked in that particular day, how many calories he has burned, possibly all this information would be transferred to a mobile with a technology known as Bluetooth. And from that mobile, it would be further stored on a server, maybe on a cloud, as you might be aware. When you have collection of server distributed at different location, what we get is nothing but a cloud. So possibly what happens is whenever I'm transferring my data on mobile through Bluetooth, mobile is not going to keep it on its own end. Further, it would be migrated and further it would be maintained on a server or maybe on a cloud. So this example, what I'm talking right now, is an example of people to things. Possibly today, doctors can monitor the patient remotely. Some parameters, but obviously. So when I'm talking about further things to things, it is communication of two entities, two devices, two machines, interacting with each other without any human intervention. So for example, as you can see, a car, the fuel in the car is possibly low, and hence automatically it is getting a signal that where is the nearest fuel station. Possibly there is an issue in the car, it is getting a signal that where is the nearest garage. Possibly there are some, this car has break some law, then possibly the police is able to track this car. So what I'm trying to tell you is, it is forming. Initially we thought of communicating people to things, then things to things, that too without human interaction, which actually led to a concept of M2M. So when I'm talking about M2M, M2M stands for a machine-to-machine communication. Now, what exactly is a machine-to-machine communication? When I'm talking about machine-to-machine communication, it is connectivity of two different devices, communication of two different devices, information sharing between two different devices, and that too without human intervention. So it is kind of machine to machine communication, which actually today is somewhere also known as Internet of Things. But then I need to first clarify the things very much clearly, that when I'm talking about people to things, when I'm talking about things to things, when I'm talking about a machine to machine, ultimately today what led to a concept is nothing but IoE. So IoE stands for Internet of Everything. So Internet of Everything is combination of IoD, IoH, IoT, but obviously IO is forming a superset of all of this terminology. So when I'm talking about IoD, imagine an era only with the smartphones. When I'm talking about IoH, Internet of Humans, possibly the interaction with the devices increase with the help of smartphones, smart bands, smart glasses, Google Glass, as you might be aware of, the smart shoes. And possibly now led to a machine-to-machine communication, which is further talking about IoT. So exactly when I'm combining all these three terminologies together, what you get is IoE. But friends, there is always there might be a confusion. That confusion which is talking about is what exactly is IIoT? Because there is a thin line difference between IoT and IIoT. Because IoT ultimately stands for industrial IoT. So when I'm talking about industrial IoT and when I'm talking about IoT, see, when we as an end user, specifically known as consumers, when we actually interact with the help of this appliances, for example, in home automation, possibly with this wearable devices. Now, what actually we get is nothing but we get something known as consumer products. So The normal IoT is the term which is referring to the consumer products IoT. But when I'm talking about industrial IoT, it is talking about the robots, the different automated machines which are used at the manufacturing supply chains or a different management system. And ultimately, this IoT is helping to build up a new device, build up a new system, build up maybe a car. So maybe an automated robot for building up the car. So when I'm talking about such architecture, it is actually known as industrial IoT. So now I have introduced what exactly is IoT, which is the term coined by Kevin Aston. Further, I was talking about the concept of IoT and IIoT. Okay, but then I wanted to somewhere make you realize how this IoT came into existence, which started with people to things, thing to things, and then further machine to machine. And today what we have a bigger research area, we are talking about IoE, that is nothing but Internet of Everything. Because ultimately today, each and every smart devices require an internet. So I'll come to that point later, but then let's focus on what are the real world applications of IoT, some important applications I'll be discussing right now. So the most commonly used and most famous to do show off application is nothing but a smart home. Just to create a humor, I said a show off, but then this smart home is actually helping many of the users to automate their home system. So when I'm talking about the concept where I'm trying to automate the home system, what exactly I'm trying to talk about is operating my lights, operating my AC, operating my refrigerator, operating my appliances remotely through my mobile. I don't have to get up, switch on the fan, then come back and sit on my sofa. I would do that with a single touch through my mobile phone. So, but obviously here, what you require an internet service, and specifically here, you require a private internet connection, a private LAN, a private Wi-Fi. So when I'm talking about a private LAN, a private Wi-Fi, I would talk about the concept of, I certainly forgot to switch off my air conditioner. Then I have not switched off my air conditioner and I'm somewhere in office. I can still start my mobile phone, switch off my AC from my office. So what I'm exactly doing is exactly I'm trying to perform a remote operation after doing possibly the controlling the appliances. So for example, setting up the temperature sensor, automatically if I set the temperature should be 22 degrees Celsius, then possibly what exactly would happen is it is going to set my room temperature, the my home AC temperature 20 degrees weather condition outside my home. So further, the most useful application for students is this intelligent alarm. Now, how exactly this intelligent alarm works? So this intelligent alarm works with the feature of it is going to track your daily activities. For example, I wake up every day 7 a.m. in the morning. I leave for my office somewhere at 8:15. I go to the nearest station. I board train at around 8:30 a.m. So possibly when I reach to a station, I realize that my train is late, maybe by 20 minutes. Then possibly I thought I might have got 20 minutes more sleep. So at 7 a.m. every day, rather than notifying you to wake up, by maybe a minute or 7 a.m., this clock is going to check your Google Map. This clock is going to check the timetable of the railway. And possibly if there is a delay, it is going to give a notification saying that you still have 20 minutes buffer because today you're possibly the train is late by 20 minutes. So what I'm trying to tell you is the example, what is being shared on your screen, you can see that it is giving a message that road is clear and you have a time to get a coffee. Possibly the user is driving the car and willing exactly to take a coffee, maybe having a habit of visiting a coffee shop while going to office, then it is a message that there is no traffic. Possibly you can wait for a coffee and just have your coffee. So it's a very good system, and certainly it is using the concept of IoT. So next, what I'm trying to talk about is smart kitchen. Everywhere, initially the smart kitchen, I have already discussed one of the components that is talking about intelligent refrigerator. So here you can make all your appliances automated. You can make all your devices intelligent enough, like a smart microwave, like a smart cooker, like a smart toast, and the user is enjoying the privilege that everything is getting ready, and he is there is no involvement of this user. So what exactly I'm trying to tell you is I'm right now trying to tell you, for example, maximum amount of time our mothers are there in engrossed in cooking, possibly with the lifestyle, some people may are going under some medication, then possibly at 9 p.m. they have to take the medicine. So in the kitchen, in one part of the corner of the kitchen, you can have a smart light. At 9 o'clock, automatically it will start blinking to just remind to take a medicine. So what you can see here is a smart kitchen, again, where you require IoT. Further, this is, I would say, an enchanted object. We never ever imagined that an umbrella would reach with us. Here, what you can see is intelligent umbrella. How exactly it is working? This umbrella would be, you'll be keeping somewhere near your door, and possibly when you're leaving, this umbrella would send a request, send the weather forecasting to a weather forecasting server, asking about whether it is going to rain or not. If it is not going to rain, fine. If it is going to rain, the LED placed on the umbrella's handle would start blinking. So this will make our user remind that, dude, carry me or else you're going to go away, because possibly today it will rain. So kind of an enchanted object we never ever imagined. This was a kind of any object talking in a cartoon series, talking in an animated series. So possibly this umbrella is making us remind, and is trying to give some useful information to us. So further, when I'm talking about is vehicle checking, and you might be aware of Ola, Uber. Now, what exactly is happening is it is trying to show you the current location of where your cab is, where your bus is, how much time it will take to reach your source. From source, how much time it would take to reach the destination, what path it is going to take. Every damn thing, every tracking is made possible due to this GPS sensor, okay, which plays a very important role, whether we are dealing with online food ordering, whether we are dealing with online shopping, whether we are dealing with any kind of transportation. So what exactly I'm trying to tell you is, I'm trying to talk about automated vehicle tracking system. Further, when I'm talking about a very good enchanted device, which almost every people today is having, is a smartwatch. Now, this smartwatch is actually a remote control to our mobile phone. So the technology has improved so much that possibly we were very much happy with the mobile phone, but now we have become so much dependent that we are not even willing to take our mobile from our pocket, from our bag. Every damn operation you can do with this smartwatch. So I would just give an example of one system known as a patient monitoring system. As you might be aware, the smartwatches today are capable of calculating your electronic cardiogram, that is the ECG, which is going to tell you about the heart condition. So all your data, like a blood pressure, ECG, pulse, how many calories you have burnt in a day, through your smartwatch, it would be recorded, it would be sent to your mobile phone. From mobile phone, it would be sent to a cloud. From cloud, your doctor can access your record remotely from any part of the world. And possibly when doctor feels some parameter is wrong, he may advise you to go to the nearest clinic. So smartwatch plays a very important role other than making the personality smart. So, but obviously, it adds a X factor to our personality. But then, what I want to right now talk about is with this ubiquitous world. So, I can operate n number of things through the smartwatch. Further, these were some basic applications of IoT which I was talking about. But now I need to make you realize how exactly is IoT built. Because by end of the session today, people who are really interested in the field of IoT, networking, embedded system, microprocessor, microcontroller, some hardware oriented subject, if they start developing interest, they can further build up a very good IoT based product. But for all this application, what physical design you actually require is, this is the block diagram of IoT. So first and foremost, you require a physical object. It can be anything. Okay, if you are aware, even you can put a GPS tracker in your pet and you can actually check where that pet is currently going. So possibly if he has lost somewhere, you can still help him to get back. So you require a physical object that is capable of giving some information. So it should not happen that you have selected a physical object and possibly just for the sake of creating an IoT product, and that physical object is not providing any spatial information. But then I would say it is a useless category. So when I'm talking about physical object, it is nothing but any entity that has a capability to give some information. But to get this information, what you require is a sensor. So what you require here, you can see, is a sensor. So sensor is an input device. This input device is responsible to take the input from the real world. Give that real world input to a device known as controller. Controller is said to be a processing device. Maybe you can use a controller like Arduino. You may go for a processor based system like a Raspberry Pi, or you may have a processing somewhere on the server, somewhere on the cloud. And possibly what is the outcome of controller would be given to an output device. That output device here is termed as actuator. But our friends, when I'm talking about sensor, controller, actuator, how this might be connected to there, for that you require an internet. So after today, if anyone asks you what exactly is the controller, you need to what it is the brain. When anyone asks you what exactly is internet, you need to answer it is heart of IoT. When you say what is a sensor, it is your input device. When you say actuator, it is your output device. When you say physical object, it is any damn entity which has a capability of giving some information, some data, which is meaning it as an information. Now let's take an example of automatic plant watering system. Now what you can see in this plant watering system here, if you see this part, it is actually talking about something known as moisture sensor, which is dipped inside the soil. This moisture sensor is now connected to your controller board, possibly an Arduino board. Okay, possibly a Raspberry Pi. So this board, from where the moisture sensor is sending the value, would go to this particular board. This board is now going to check the moisture content value. If the moisture is high, no need to water the plant. If the moisture has reduced, it will give command to this water motor. Okay, so water motor is acting as our actuator. which will start supplying water to this plant. As soon as the moisture content increases, automatically this particular device is going to stop the water pump for supplying water to this plant. Now, this was a prototype model, but this is very famous today in the automatic irrigation system. When I'm talking about automatic irrigation system, it is very helpful for farmers. They don't have to manually go and plant the crops. Okay, it would be done with the help of this automatic watering system. So there you require an internet, there you the sensors would be remotely present, because here it is a direct connection. Then one more good example of IoT, I would say, is a goodnight lamp. So if you see this, there are two types of lamps in this architecture. Possibly imagine a situation where a child is studying in US and his parents in India. Parents are in India. What exactly would generally happen? The parents land up calling when the child is sick, possibly, or when child is maybe sleeping, and then they realize we unnecessarily disturb him. So what exactly is this goodnight lamp works is, this is the lamp, what you can see over here, it has the switch. This lamp would be there with the child in US. And probably this orange color lamp, which is the secondary lamp, which doesn't have a switch into it, is kept at the parents' place. So when the child is free, he's gonna switch on this light. As soon as he switches on this light, what will happen? The secondary lamp, which is there in India at the child's parents' place, it would be automatically started. This will indicate to parents that their child is right now free. When probably the child is busy, he would switch off this light. Automatically, the light in India at his parents' place would be switched off. This will indicate the parents that possibly the child is busy. So how exactly it works? It is, but obviously through internet. So possibly here there might be an Arduino sensing the light and possibly sending the information to this device through internet to switch on or switch off the light. So up till now, what exactly is IoT we have understood? What are the different applications of IoT we have understood? We have also seen the different components of IoT, how exactly the building block of IoT is made. But now we need to break each and everything and realize what all things we require for implementing this IoT. So first and foremost, you need to be clear with the concept that what would be your input and how you're going to take the input and how you're going to present the output. So these are the devices which are responsible to take the input and give the output. So they have the feature, electrical feature of transducer that converts one part of energy into another part of energy. So possibly what happens is, here the sensor is a microphone. Here is the controller, which is an amplifier. And here the actuator is nothing but a speaker. But then just right now, to give an example, the sensors are responsible to get the real world input. And actuators are responsible to give real world output. Now what happens? The real world input and the real world output are in analog form. But the issue is that the controller, the processor today only understands the digital language. So sensors are responsible to take the input. They are in the analog form, convert that analog input into a digital input and give it to an amplifier with the help of ADC, which stands for analog to digital converter. At the output of the processor, the output would be in the digital form. So that output would be now converted back into the analog form, for which you require a DAC, that is digital to analog converter. So these are the few examples of sensors. So DHT11, DHT22 are the humidity and the temperature sensors. BMP180 is measuring the air pressure. Capacitive sensors, smoke detector, gas sensor, gas leakage sensor, PIR sensors, rainwater sensor. Possibly many of the new car has this feature of automatic wiper system where the wipers would automatically start when it starts running. A pulse sensor, which is there in your smartwatch. A fingerprint sensor, that is nothing but your fingerprint scanner, which is used for biometric authentication. So these are few examples of sensors. But now the question is, how these sensors would be connected to the controller? What kind of protocol these sensors might be using to interact with the controller? So now what we need to focus upon is the concept of sensor communication protocols and technologies. So when I'm talking about sensor communication protocols and the technologies, I am actually talking about what are the technologies. It can be a wired technology, it can be a wireless technology. As you have seen in the previous slide, when I was talking about this automatic plant watering system, this was purely a wired technology and there was no wireless communication involved in this. So how this happens, that we would talk about the direct connection with this auxiliary devices later. But I'm right now talking about the technologies which is focusing on wireless technology. So the first commonly used wireless technology is Bluetooth. So possibly a CCTV camera is transferring data through a Bluetooth. The lights are controlled through a Bluetooth. So what I'm trying to tell you is, a few sensors are working with the help of this Bluetooth technology. But when I'm talking about home automation, when I'm setting up a home automation system, I won't go for a Bluetooth system, rather I would go for a Wi-Fi system. So as you are aware, when I'm talking about this Wi-Fi system, as you are aware of the concept, how exactly it is working is this 802.11 standard where all your sensors, for example, a fan sensor, a light sensor, an air conditioning sensor, a refrigerator sensor, all these sensors are connected to a common router forming a small intranet, and possibly this private network is through this router, through this gateway, would be connected to the external world. So the next technology for sensor communication, what you can think of is 802.11, a very famous Wi-Fi. But then today the things are improving, and then what we are land up with a new technology developed by Sony and a company called as NXP Semiconductor is nothing but NFC. NXP semiconductor is nothing but NFC. NFC stands for near field communication, which actually works on the principle of RFID, radio frequency identification, and possibly it is working on this principle of electromagnetic field. So even my home theater system today supports Bluetooth as well as NFC. Your wireless charging is a big example of NFC. Samsung Pay, paying with the help of a credit card, that too without physically removing the credit card, is an example. What actually you can see is metering system. Initially the people for electricity, for water consumption, they used to come, they used to check the meter, manually write down, and then go submit in the office, and then the bill was calculated. Here with the NFC, you simply tap on the meter and you'll get the readings. So again, this is a wireless technology used by the different sensors. But then these were the technologies. You require some rules and regulations for communication, and that is nothing but you need to understand the concept of protocols for wireless communication, and the very famous protocol for wireless communication here, I am using something known as ZigBee. So ZigBee is an American company. Now what generally happens, sensors are using one feature. That feature is known as they are low power devices. So when I'm talking about their low power devices, just HTTP, the traditional protocols of networking, they would consume a lot of power. And the basic functionality of sensor, the basic feature of a sensor, which claims that it is a low power devices, would be lost. So exactly, to handle such a situation, what came into existence was this ZigBee network. Now ZigBee forms a protocol. So what you can see, or in green color, they are these ZigBee end devices. They are our sensors. They are communicating with each other with the help of this ZigBee routers. And there is a ZigBee coordinator, which is actually trying to connect a ZigBee network to the existing network. So whatever data is coming from existing network would be in the form of HTTP, HTTPS. And whatever data would be entered in the ZigBee network would be in the form of ZigBee. So this coordinator is responsible to convert HTTP, HTTPS protocol to ZigBee protocol and vice versa. So up till now, we have seen the wireless technology and one basic protocol known as ZigBee. Further, there is one more protocol which I would say is a very good protocol known as Z-Wave. Now, what happens with Z-Wave is, imagine I have a light, its sensor. I have a fan, its sensor. I have an AC, its sensor. I have a TV, its sensor. I have a refrigerator, its sensor. I have a cooker, its sensor, and so on. Now, what happened is, all these are not in the same room. They are they are present in some different rooms. So what exactly happened is, I need to set up all these devices in such a way that it should be connected to a common router. So this common router is acting as our gateway. But now this, in Z-Wave, the sensor has a feature of repeater. The sensor has a capability to pass on the data further to actual router. So when this particular LAN is connected, it is not directly connected to this particular router. It is connected to neighboring sensor. And now from neighboring sensor, it is connected to this particular router. So here the connection to the router is to this particular light. But then if you talk about this light, it is not directly connected to this router. It is connected via different sensors. So here what you get, it is kind of a mesh topology. Generally what you have seen in IoT is a star topology. Here the sensors would connect to each other, and finally one of the sensors would be connected to this gateway, creating the complexity or reducing the complexity of the architecture, and hence making the system simple enough to build as well as simple enough to understand. But then now we have realized ZigBee is there, Z-Wave is there. ZigBee and Z-Wave ultimately both are same. This is the coordinator which would be performing the conversion. But ZigBee requires every sensors to connect it to a specific router and then to a gateway. Here the sensors are acting itself as a router, itself as a repeater, to pass on the data to the actual coordinator. But then let us understand how exactly the protocol, the communication between the sensor works. For that, we need to understand MQTT, Message Queuing Telemetry Transport. So what exactly is this MQTT, which stands for Message Queuing Telemetry Transport? Let us understand. This MQTT uses, imagine this as your mobile, this as your master device. This is your client one, the sensor of your home AC. This is your client two, the sensor of your office AC. So this MQTT works on the principle of push-pull architecture, subscribe and publish method. Now, the first thing master would publish, the first thing is the topic. So if you see topic 1 slash home slash AC. Now this slash home slash AC would be, but obviously subscribed by home AC sensor. And this slash home slash office slash AC topic would be subscribed by the client 2, which is nothing but office sensor. Now your master will put a message. For example, you want to set the temperature of home AC to 22.5 degrees Celsius. So the message one would be slash home slash AC. So it is under topic 1 where I'm setting up the message temp equal to 22.5. And this would be published only to client 1 because it has subscribed to that particular topic, green color topic. Now, if I need to set office temperature to 24, so it would be message 2. There is a small mistake. It would be slash office slash AC. That is topic 2, under which there would, I would set up a message. I would publish a message known as temperature equal to 24. And this message would be published to client 2 because client 2 has published to this topic. So this MQTT broker, generally the name of the MQTT broker, what we actually use is known as Mosquito. So master is responsible to publish the topic. The slaves are responsible to subscribe to that topic. And then when master in that topic further publishes the message, only the sensors who have subscribed to that topic would get those messages. So this is how actually the sensor communication works. So we have seen the technologies like NFC, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi. We have seen the low powered feature maintaining concept like Zigbee and Z-Wave, and then the sensor communication protocol, for example MQTT, message queuing telemetry transport. So right now we have seen the aspects of sensors. Now what exactly happens is we are talking about the auxiliary devices. When I'm talking about auxiliary devices, these are nothing but the processors, the controllers that we would be using. For example, when I'm talking about the first controller we would be focusing on is a microcontroller based architecture known as Arduino. So what you can see on the screen, you can see a basic architecture of Arduino, which is created by Massimo Banzi and David Kuratlis in 2005. Initially, when we were building up our own embedded system, we used to have a different board and then as per our requirement, place our microcontroller, place the input port, place the output port and so on. So here, what is the feature of this Arduino? It has a total 14 digital input-output pins, 0 to 13. It has total 6 analog input pins. So this device has a feature of only taking analog input but only giving digital output. It can also have digital in, but analog in only, no analog output. You have a microcontroller, as you can see over here, Atmega 328. You have a USB interface to connect to a PC. You have an external power supply to provide a power supply to this particular device when it is not connected to your computer. So what generally happens is you need to purchase this board. Okay, it is known as an open source hardware. Now, why it is known as an open source hardware? Because its design is freely available over the network. So how exactly you would be programming this is, you need to install, you need to download Arduino IDE, install it, and by default, you'll get two functions into that program. Now, we never call it as a program, we call it as a sketch. In Arduino, programming means a sketching. So whatever code you need to write, you just write it, and then you just upload that particular code on this Arduino. And the Arduino would start acting as per the program which is being uploaded over here. There is a replacement. If you don't have a hardware, you can start practicing on an Arduino simulator, for example, a Tinkercad. Further, this was a controller-based system responsible to do a specific task. Further, IoT has also involved a very good processing system known as Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi is a credit card size CPU developed by Eben Upon. Now, this Raspberry Pi is not a controller-based system. It is a processor-based system. Controller has a feature of doing a specific job. Processor has a feature of doing multiple tasks. So what exactly is, you can see on the board, is you have a USB port. You have a LAN port, which was missing in Arduino. You have a HDMI to connect to your monitor. You have a RAM. You have a processor. You have a digital input output pins here known as GPIO, general purpose input output pins. You have a older video port. You have an audio port. You have a unbuilt a camera port. And for a secondary memory, we also have this SD card, which is acting as our secondary memory. So the main aim was only for the study purpose. This Raspberry Pi is known as open source hardware as well as open source software. Open source hardware is nothing but its design is freely available. Whereas when I'm talking about source software, here it is using an operating system because it is a computer-based system. So it is using an operating system known as Linux-based operating system whose name is Raspbian Pi. So Raspberry Pi is a processor-based system, whereas Arduino is a controller-based system, and hence Raspberry Pi requires an operating system to make it work. Arduino requires only whatever programming you do would be uploaded on the Arduino's board. So this is a few examples of exemplary devices. And now even Intel has entered into this field of IoT by designing a very good controller system known as Intel Galileo, which is a combination of Arduino and Raspberry Pi. But mark my words, it is not a processing based system like Raspberry Pi. It is a controller based system like Arduino with some added feature which are missing in Arduino. Further, how this when we have seen this automated plant watering system, the moisture sensor was directly connected to this controller. Now, what are the different controller interfaces that we would be actually using to make this sensor communicate with the controller board and controller board to interact with this sensor? So we have a very two good famous protocols, I2C, that is inter-integrated circuit developed by Philips in the year mid-1980s. And some improvement over it, we got serial peripheral interface developed by Motorola again in mid-1980s. So how exactly it works, let us try to understand one by one I2C and SPI. I would again repeat one statement that whenever you are connecting your sensors directly to the controller, you need to use this controller interface. If you are not directly connecting through a cable, through a wire, through a direct cable to your controller, possibly you would go in a land up in a wireless environment, for which we have already seen what are the different wireless technologies and wireless protocols. So how exactly this I2C works? It is a synchronized device because it has a clock. There are three devices. Assume these three devices as a sensor, and the RPI is nothing but a master. This is our controller board. These devices would be connected to a common serial clock and to a common serial data line, as you can see in the diagram. These devices are lazy. They are sleeping all the time. If master wants to interact with any of the slave, for example, with device 2, it will first pass on the clock pulse on SCL. This clock pulse acts as an alarm and make all other devices active. Now these devices are, which are active, that is device 1, device 2, device 3, would now check SDA, that is serial data. The master is going to place address of the device, that is device 2, on this serial data. This message, this address would be sent to all. Device 1 again would go in a sleep mode. Device 3 would go on a sleep mode, but device 2 would be activated because master has inserted the address of device 2 on SDA line. Device 2 will now give a feedback saying that I'm ready for the communication on the same SDA line. And now the communication would start. Master would send data on SDA. Device 2 will accept that data, give an acknowledgement on the same line SDA. Then your master would send the second set of data. Now the disadvantage is this is half duplex communication, possibly because at a time only one device is communicating. To overcome this, we developed SPI. SPI, which is again a synchronized device, has a common clock, SCLK, which stands for serial clock. You have MOSI, that is master out, slave in. This is a output line for a master and input line for a slave. Miso, that is mastering slave out, output of slave given as the input to master, and CS, chip select. It works very much similar to I2C. Let us understand its working principle. If possibly master wants to interact with device 2, it will first send a clock pulse on SCK, which will make all the device go in an active mode. Now your master is going to put address of device 2 on CS, chip select. And this will make your device 1, device 3 to go back and again start and go back in that passive mode, sleep, and device 2 would be activated. And now both master and slave can interact with each other at the same time, simultaneously through this MOSI and MISO line, hence leading to a full duplex communication. Working principle of SPI is same as I2C. I2C was half duplex, SPI was full duplex. Now I would again reiterate one thing. When you are connecting any of the sensor to a controller board directly to a through a cable, you require this controller interfaces, or else you will be dealing with wireless technologies like Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, NFC. Further, we need to understand, for example, we are dealing with a home automation where we are not using this wired technology, but we are using this wireless technology. Then possibly what exactly we need this concept of gateway. So as you have seen in ZigBee, there was a coordinator. So when there was a coordinator, how exactly it was working is this ZigBee coordinator is responsible to connect the external network understanding HTTP, HTTPS to an internal network only understanding ZigBee. So now how exactly is this gateway working is you can see the IoT devices. They are working with in any of the any of the wireless technology and using any protocol like ZigBee. To connect to the external network, they require a gateway. So the devices would be connected to this external network with the help of this gateway. So this gateway act as a middleman to connect the internal network consisting of IoT devices to the external network consisting of servers, cloud, etc. So when to use a gateway is when you need to send your internal data to the external world. I would use this concept of gateway. But the issue with, if I have already told you one thing, that the issue with sensors is they are low powered. So when I'm talking about low power sensors, they really mean that the battery life should be very, very good enough. And then possibly if they are using a traditional LAN, traditional MAN technology, there is possibility that the battery life would be reduced. The battery would start draining more and more with this heterogeneous network. So what is developed for this internet of things is LPWAN, which stands for low power WAN. For example, I'm talking about LoRa. Okay, LoRa stands for low range network. When I'm talking about low range network, it is very famous only for a sensor network. Wherever you see WSN, wireless sensor network, it is using this LoRa architecture. So the journey to just to for example, LPWAN, you have many other technologies like Sigfox. You have a technology we are talking about concept of there is Sigfox. We have a concept of Cat LTE. We have narrowband WAN technology. So these are few examples of LPWAN. So finally, for giving me the concluding remarks, we need to first understand what exactly is IoT. We need to understand, if we need to build up a system, we need to first understand, we need to identify physical object. What kind of sensor you would like to apply on that physical object? this sensor, how it is going to connect to the controller through wire technology, then possibly you might have to go for I2C or SPI. If wireless, possibly you need to select upon Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, I2C. To handle the heterogeneity, you need to focus upon ZigBee or Z-Wave. And for communication, you'll be using MQTT. Now you need to decide upon which controller you're using, whether you'll be going for Arduino, whether you'll be going for Raspberry Pi, whether you'll be going for Intel Galileo. And now you need to finalize upon what would be your actuator to present the output to the world. So you need to first have the object ready, select the sensor, select the communication protocol, select the controller, select the type of LPWAN, select the communication protocol, decide upon the actuator. So up till now, we have only seen the concept. Now we need to start programming. So to start programming, it depends. If you're using Arduino, you may you'll be using its own IDE, probably running with C and C++. And probably if you want to program the Raspberry Pi, you will be programming the concept of something known as Python programming. So as rightly said by Kevin Kelly, that dumb parts properly connected into a swarm would definitely yield into a smart results. So all our phones would be dumb if there is no internet connection. So and only not the internet connection, if they are not even having the thinking capability, possibly they would be termed as the dumb devices. So I believe the connection is established successfully, at least for the initial level of initial research of what exactly is IoT, how to build up an IoT system, and how to, at least I have given you a path about how to start with IoT. So this is Professor Amit Kanurkar, working as an assistant professor in Vidyalankar Institute of Technology, convener of CSI VIT, signing off for this today's event. And then I would hand over this control to Uma Madam. So thank you. Thank you very much. So yeah, Sumati Madam, Shamla Madam, you can just take over the communication. So if you have any doubt, you can just mail that to me at any point of time. So I believe I'll stop.
Okay, sir. Sorry, yeah. Sir, can you hear me?
Hello? Stop sharing my screen.
Ah, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Thank you for your wonderful session, sir. There is some question from the chat box. What are security concerns related to IoT?
When it is coming to networking, but obviously, the security issues like authentication, authorization, and the main issue of man in the middle attack would threat our system, and then hence the any communication we are doing should be in a encrypted form, and then only the valid user having a proper right should be allowed to access our IoT architecture. So the security issues would be handled by the basic security issues using this good encryption, decryption, authentication, and authorization techniques.
Thank you, sir. And next question. So what is the difference between a wireless sensor network and the Internet of Things network, that is IoT network?
Okay. Wireless sensor network are forming a sensor network interacting with each other through a wireless technology. Okay, possibly the most commonly used wireless sensor network technology is through your Wi-Fi. When I'm talking about IoT network, IoT is using one of these architectures, probably a wireless sensor network, probably a wired sensor network. So IoT is using one of this architecture. So IoT is not forming its own network. It is using one of the architectures to create a network.
Next question. So what does it mean by smart city regarding to the IoT? What does it mean by smart
city? Smart city, New York and Singapore, they have a very good implementation of smart city. When I'm talking about a smart city, it is everything in the city is connected for the betterment of the citizen of that particular city, for that particular country. Right now, I'm not talking about country, but at least for that particular city, that automatically looking at the traffic, the signal would go green. Possibly, people are waiting for crossing. Then the automatically the signals would go red for the cars, and it will allow the pedestrian to cross. Automatically telling all the citizen about the air pollution, about the weather condition. Every damn thing in the city would be operated with the help of this sensor network.
Thank you, sir. Next question. What is the top 5 machine-to-machine application in the world, sir?
Top 5 machine-to-machine. Firstly, you can go for an industrial IoT where there is a smooth handover from one robot to another robot for assembly. The machine-to-machine communication, what you can refer to is your even smartphone communicating with your mobile phone is seamlessly without any kind of human intervention. You have a system that is that are used in medical applications for automatically. But there is some. The physical object would be the human being, where it would continuously monitor your record of possibly the heart rate or heartbeat, and then continuously sending that data through a sensor. So these are a few applications which are dealing with machine-to-machine communication.
Next question, sir. Whether the IoT is used in automated cars?
Yes, IoT is definitely used in automated cars. For example, even Tesla, when it is going for working in automatic mode, it is entirely with the help of this sensor communication, and the maps are actually helping out for trying to identify how much is the traffic ahead, and is there any car coming from behind, and then possibly locating the car. Every aspect of this automated car would require a concept of IoT. Possibly, probably, I would say, the more of the sensor communication network.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful session. And on behalf of the management principal and faculty of Computer Science, Computer Application, and PG Department of Information Technology, Dr. M.J. Janaki College of Arts and Science for Women, it gives an immense pleasure for me to propose a vote of thanks. Like in thanking all our webinar, national webinar lecture series for a resource person, Dr. T.S. Hari Narayanan, Dr. Angelina Sita, Mr. Swapnil, and Mr. Amit for sharing their vibrant and enriched talk and on impact and application of Industry 4.0 after lockdown. I thank all the participants for their warmest support in making this webinar a grand success. Hope all the participants have successfully submitted their feedback form for e-certificate. The certificate is issued only for those participants who have submitted the feedback form. Thank you once again. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. It was my pleasure. I would first like to thank Dr. Sumati, Dr. Uma ma'am, even Shamla ma'am for giving such a good platform for us to present. And definitely, if you have any doubt, I have shared my email address, so you can anytime contact me for any doubts if you have. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.